want one from here.
Oh, we have one viewer. We didn't even advertise.
This is curtain times.
I'll just keep this one, and then we'll make sure that we leave the one in that stand, so I'll make sure they agree. Because when we go into our, because we got a thing all the time, so we'll go to leave one, so in case Eric goes up to make a reading, and then you see how us singers, we all have the scripture reading.
Thank you. praise and thank you, Lord, for this privilege, this honor, to be united together as thy people, to worship you, to honor you, to pray to you, Father. And we pray, Lord, that this evening you may empty our minds of any heavy burdens, Father.
Yes, Father.
Help us, Father, to allow our minds to flow towards heaven. We pray that your Holy Spirit may get hold of us. May cleanse us.
Yes.
May fill us with your grace, with your love.
Yes.
Your Holy Spirit may help us to be united.
Yes.
So Father, we a privilege indeed. So please, with your holy presence, bless us, Father.
Yes.
As we pray, as we honor you. As you glorify him. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Praise
you. Well, actually, I'm going to have to stand back up. Well, I know someone that you do not know. Go to that person and introduce yourself to them and let them know you're glad they're with you.
There it is. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Happy Wednesday to each and every one of you. I have been posed with the task of dealing with what it means to seek the mind of God. And as I thought about seeking God's mind, I want to ask you a question. You know, sometimes you wonder, you've heard the phrase, if I would give you a penny for your work. And so we want to know what the thoughts are of other people. Question is, do we ever wonder what God's thoughts are? We wonder, you know, we wonder what's on our wives' mind, what's on our husband's mind, sometimes it's on the pastor's mind. You ever wonder what's on God's mind? And if you do have that question, the question is it possible for us to know what's on God's mind? There's a scripture that comes to mind. And it's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse number 9. And I'm going to read the verse 16. It says, but it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man, things that God has prepared for those who love Him. Now, we know that just because we identify very well with the kingdom of God, with the things that God has for us in the afterlife or eternity to come. But there's some other verses that come after that that are so important. But God has revealed them to us through His Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things. Yes, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. These things we also speak not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. Verse 15 now. But he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is rightly judged by no one else. For who has known the mind of the Lord that he might instruct him? But catch what the Bible says. For we have one. It is possible for us to know what is on the mind of God because there is one who knows the mind of God, and His name is the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Word already teaches us that He searches the deep things of God. So, as it relates to St. Louis, and it relates to the Holy Spirit revealing to us what is God's mindset toward this city? Do we have any way of being able to come? Well, you know, the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit comes, there are several things that He does. The Holy Spirit in Galatians 5, He gives the fruit of the Spirit. But we also know that the Holy Spirit also has what's called the gifts of the Spirit.
Amen.
One of those gifts that we know well, that we say is one of the identifying marks of the River Church, is the gift of prophecy. You know what I'm talking about. The Bible says in Revelation 14, boy, we still remember this, that the dragon was wroth with the woman and they went to make war with the remnant of her seed who have the what? Who keep the commandments of God and have the what? Testimony of Jesus Christ. And then in Revelation 19:10, the Lord says that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Well, we as a church believe that the Lord has given us a prophet, right?
Amen.
And so, this Father, through the Spirit, who knows the mind of God, has said a couple things to us about the city of St. Louis. Manuscript 13, 19:10. It is entitled, Time to Wake Up the Watcher. It says, our cities are to be worked. Money is needed for the prosecution of the work in New York, Boston, Portland, Philadelphia, Buffalo, Chicago, and then she says, St. Louis,
amen.
New Orleans, and many other cities. In some of these places, the people were violently stirred by the message But in the latter years, little has been done compared to the great work that ought to be in progress. And it seems difficult to make our people feel a special burden for the work in the Lord's hands. We still have that challenge, don't we?
Yeah.
You remember some years ago, I think it was in the early 1900s, that there was what was called the St. Louis Fair. Anybody remember that? Servant of the Lord says that I was given instruction that as we approach the end, there should be large gatherings in our cities, as there have been recently been in St. Louis. She then says that at every large gathering, some of our members or our ministers should be in attendance. They should work wisely to obtain the hearing and get the light of truth before as many as possible. She says, we should improve every such opportunity as that presented by the St. Louis Fair. At all of those such gatherings, there should be present men whom God can use.
Amen.
Then I close with this one. Evangelism, page 401, paragraph 2. She says that you may speak of the work which will be done in America, but which is undone. I wish to speak of these neglected fields as are presented to me. I wish to speak not merely in behalf of the southern people, but in behalf of the large cities, whose neglected, unworn condition is a condemnation to our people who claim to be the missionaries of the master. We stand rebuked by God because the large cities right within our sight are unworked and unworn. A terrible change or charge of neglect is brought against those who have been lawfully working in this very America and yet have not entered the large cities. What has been done in Philadelphia, in New Orleans, and then she says, in St. Louis, and in other cities that I like name? Catch this. She says, we have done none too much for foreign fields, but we have done comparatively nothing for the large cities right beside our own doors. That statement was written in 1905. We are more than 100+ years from that statement. Almost 108 years when it's the Bible. Simply that we work our large cities. The time is now to be present in all the large cities. Not to sit back and say, we don't need to be there, because those places are worldly, but we need to be there with our voices, with our literature. We're planting cities, bringing lost souls to Christ. So what's on the mind of God?
Yes.
Seven.
Amen.
And he's here for you, and I'm glad you chose to come and be here with him. The first part is adoration and praise. It is a powerful experience to begin our prayer time with adoration and praise. We are speaking to the mighty God of the universe. We serve this mighty God. We want to praise him for his wondrous works in our lives and tell him what he means to us and what he's done. In this next phase will be confession. We will focus our prayers on bringing to God our request of forgiveness and cleansing, not only of our individual sins, but as a people as a whole. This clears the path for God to hear our prayers as a group. Allow God to impress your mind with any sin that you need to confess. These prayers may also be prayed silently, as you may have something that is really old between you and the Lord. The next one is supplication. This is where we get to take God at his word. He tells us to ask, to seek, and to knock, and he wants to draw near. He wants to be close. He wants us to hide under his wing. He's our refuge, our strength, and our wisdom. Don't be afraid to ask big things of God. He's big enough to take it, and he tells us so. So plead for the Holy Spirit. Plead for people's salvation. Plead for God to reveal himself to you and to open doors for the spreading of his word. And then praise him as he answers your prayers. He will ask in mighty or answer in mighty ways. Lastly, Thanksgiving, I want you to give God your thanks for hearing our prayers and for the answers that he's already provided. Do you believe that anything that happens in your life comes as a surprise to God? Do you believe that he has a thousand ways to answer that prayer?
Amen.
These are already in motion.
Amen.
And if you doubt that, I want you to come talk to me later. Because you all will pray together about that. He has many ways of working things out, and he has given us already many gifts that we want to thank him for. Thank him for salvation, for our lives, for our family, for our friends, especially finishing the Thanksgiving holiday we just did. And also praise and thank God in faith for knowing that he will hear our prayers and answer those prayers that we just prayed for in that previous supplication time. As we go through this, you're going to be led by the praise team through each song, or through each phase of the song, signaling the completion of that time of prayer. And then we move on to the next phase. So the way this is going to work is that I would ask that you each would come off into small groups. And with the smaller number of people we have here tonight, it would probably be better that you glue yourselves to maybe even three to four people, people that you don't know, people that you have prayed with before, people not in your church. This is a great time to get to know and spread those fellowship feelings with everybody else. After we've taken a minute and everybody has already gotten settled, then we will start our first prayer season with a song. And I will remind that those folks that are praying together after each one, that you'll group together yourselves and have a mic that you're speaking to the mic during the scripture readings as well. And we'll have mics for our praise team too. And we'll just start and take you through the process. So at this time, if you would go ahead, break up into small groups throughout the sanctuary. We'll be getting started here.
Those that will be praying, the elders and the sisters that will be praying, would you please come up to this area right here? Thank you.
I'm reading Psalms 22, verses 25 and 26, reading from the New King James Version. My praise shall be on you in the great assembly. I will pay my vows before those who fear. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him will praise the Lord. Let your heart live forever.
You may now begin praying in adoration.
Thank you.
have called us together this evening for a time of prayer. We thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness towards your people and to all your churches. We thank you because your love endures forever. And so this evening, we pray that you grant us eternal hope, your faithfulness. Please grant us eternal life with you.
Yes.
For we pray in the worthy name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Dear Father in heaven, as we have come before you this evening, we have gathered in prayer, dear Lord, at this time, we ask for your forgiveness. We are so thankful that you are such a loving Father,
yes,
and you are so faithful and merciful, dear Lord. For we are an unclean lips and unclean hearts. We
yes.
have fallen, and we seem to trip and fall on some of the same things over and over. But you are so faithful. If we come to you and ask for forgiveness, you say, what sin? You fulfill your promise, as you always have. We claim the blood of your Son Jesus to atone for our sins.
Yes.
And Lord, we ask that we won't let Satan weigh us down and bind us a feeling that we are not good enough, because we are, is the truth. But through your victory, we claim Jesus' blood is sufficient to atone for our sins.
Yes.
And so we individually and corporately ask now, dear Father, that you would forgive us of our sins and help us to have the mind we have to live for.
Yes.
And in your Son's name, we claim these promises.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Lord, as we humble ourselves and come to your throne of mercy and grace, we pray for kindness. Lord, we give you thanks for the university and all that it is now and is doing to prepare us for the great work of spreading the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We ask in a mighty special way, Lord God, that you bless each soul that is represented here tonight. Keep us steadfast and strong, Lord God. Keep us humble. And as you said in your word, Lord God, Matthew 7, you said ask. So we're asking, Heavenly Father, for an outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Lead, guide, and direct us, Lord God, and love us to do your perfect will. Bless us, Lord God, those souls that once we have learned how to best reach out and to share this gospel, spread this message, we pray that we be led by the Holy Spirit. Bless all those that lead out, Lord God. Keep us, save us, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thanks in our mortal bodies and minds and muster together to praise and honor.